Hi, I'm Dr. Rob Rozbruch at the Hospital for Special Surgery. My entire career has been here at HSS in New York City. I'm currently a professor of clinical orthopedic surgery. I'm the chief of the Limb Lengthening and Complex Reconstruction Service, and I'm the director of the Osseointegration Limb Replacement Center at HSS. I'm really proud of the accomplishments that we've made over the last number of years. This video is going to really focus on osseointegration and this new center that we've created over the last 8 years. So, what is osseointegration? Amputation surgery has had very few advances over the last couple of hundred years. It's a very common surgery, commonly needed surgery, and it's really one of the first surgical procedures that has been around. So traditionally, when an amputation was necessary, it was performed, and then the reconstruction afterward was really limited to using a prosthetic, and socket technology has been the mainstay of prosthetic care for a couple of hundred years now. That's how you'd connect the prosthetic to the patient. I like to use the analogy of a denture for somebody that's missing their teeth. You know, the connection between the patient and the prosthetic was limited at best. So in the last few years, there have been a lot of advancements in prosthetic technology. The legs have become much more sophisticated. For transfemoral amputees, we're using microchip processors that enable the transfemoral amputee to have better control of the prosthetic knee. For transtibial amputees, there are fancy, new, high-energy feet that have a lot of potential energy built into them. But the essential problem has been connecting the prosthetic to the patient. And that connection has been compromised. People lose energy and they lose stability in the connection point between the prosthetic and the patient. And that's where osseointegration comes in, and that's where it has been transformative. Osseointegration is a direct skeletal connection between the prosthetic limb and the patient. And that is an incredible advance because now you accomplish two major things. One is you get rid of the socket. The socket's not comfortable. Patients complain about having a socket. It's too tight, it's too loose, it's sweaty, it causes blisters, it causes ulcerations. I'd make a quick turn and my body goes one way and my leg goes the other way, etc., etc. So there are a lot of problems with it. The biomechanics of a socket are compromised. It doesn't provide the stability so that the forces generated by the patient's muscles are not fully executed by the limb. Sometimes another metaphor I like to use for that is imagine a professional cyclist getting out there with flip-flops on pedals, right? They're not connected to the machine, and because of that, they lose a lot of efficiency. So what osseointegration does is it gets rid of the socket, and it allows this direct skeletal connection with the prosthetic limb, and patients' mobility soars. It soars. I mean, we have been doing this now for 8+ years. We've got over 200 cases, 200 patients under our belt at this point. And we are seeing in all of our longitudinal studies that patients' mobility, patient-reported outcomes are tremendously improved with osseointegration. People are happier, they have better endurance, they have less pain, and they have better functionality. All right, so let's talk about the nuts and bolts of osseointegration surgery. It varies from what can be a relatively straightforward surgery, which really only involves inserting the osseointegration implant into the bone, to one that's more extensive and that includes plastic surgery work and nerve reconstruction work at the same time. So when I see a patient, I evaluate them certainly by examining them, examining the residual limb, looking at x-rays, and a CT scan is really, really important to help with understanding the bony anatomy and sizing the implant. I then make a decision based on the physical exam and the history. Is this a simple osseointegration case? Sometimes we will call it PERC or percutaneous. There are cases where there's not a lot of extra soft tissue. There really aren't any significant nerve issues or problems. And we will make a small aperture, literally the size of the stem, and we will insert the osseointegration implant. Osseointegration implants are custom-made implants. They are made off of the CT scan, so they're perfectly sized and fitted for each patient individually. That type of approach is a relatively simple surgery. Now, there are other patients that have more complicated problems. Sometimes amputations are associated with chronic nerve pain, chronic irritating phantom nerve pain, and sometimes there is excessive skin and soft tissue that also needs to be addressed. In those cases, we will address everything. Sometimes we will bring a plastic surgeon in to help us, depending on the complexity of the situation. And we will do not only the osseointegration procedure, which is insertion of the implant, but we will also do a nerve reconstruction, and we will also do nip and tuck type of work, what's called a thigh lift or a leg lift, to remove and contour the excessive soft tissue. Sometimes people are interested in what these implants actually look like, and so here's a great example of what an implant is. I will point out a couple of important things. Number one is it's made out of titanium, which is a metal that interacts really, really nicely with human bone. Bone is attracted to titanium and actually has a tendency to grow into it. If you look carefully at this implant, it's textured, so it's a porous coated titanium implant, and so the bone grows into all these little millions of little nooks and crannies. And so once the osseointegration is complete, the bone is literally connected. Bone, as many of you know, is hollow. It's kind of like a pipe. And so the osseointegration implant is impacted into the bone in such a fashion. There's immediate stability that is achieved. After surgery, we will typically rest patients for a few weeks. And after the initial period of rest, we will do a progressive loading program, which also goes on for a few weeks. And that leads up to the final phase, which is the new leg. And the new leg is typically applied at about 2 months after the initial surgery. The surgery itself is a single stage surgery, right? We do the implantation and the creation of the aperture all in one stage. And the average time frame is that the patient is getting their new osseointegration leg at about 2 months after the surgery. So people ask me about outcomes, and so we're an academic medical center, and we have a database on our patients. We've done over 200 cases. We've just recently accumulated our data for the transfemoral osseointegrations and the transtibial osseointegrations. In both groups, we have found that the patient-reported outcomes are significantly better in all domains. We have found that functional testing, such as K-level, various tests called time to get up and go, 2-minute walk test, 6-minute walk test, and the number of hours that the patients are wearing the prosthetic significantly increases. And while there are some complications, the complication risk is pretty low. And the likelihood of having a successful implant, an implant that's retained and that is highly functional, is in the high 90s. Sometimes the question is, it seems scary to have this aperture made, right? I mean, people are comfortable with the idea of putting an implant in the leg. The implant itself is a lot like a hip replacement, right? It's a titanium implant that is inserted into the bone. The bone grows into the implant. And so we're pretty much familiar with that in the orthopedic community, and it works really, really well. The scary part of this might be that there's an aperture. There's this kind of hole in the skin, and the device then comes to the outside world and that's the connection point to the prosthetic. So you as a patient may be concerned about that aperture. And I would say to you, listen, the aperture is well tolerated the vast, vast majority of the time. It's like a piercing, right? I mean, people have an earring, and there's a hole in their skin, and it develops a relationship with a piece of metal. And in the beginning, it might be a little red, it might be a little irritated, but it's very high quality metal. And in the end, it is generally very well tolerated. Hygiene is important. You gotta take a daily shower, you gotta clean it with soap and water, you gotta make sure not to put your fingers in, you know, in the aperture and play with it. And that's a way to prevent problems and infections. Having said that, people are worried, well, am I going to get an infection? So there, I think one thing that it's important to understand is not all infections are created equal, okay? So a superficial infection, something where the skin gets a bit irritated, that happens, and occasionally a patient may need to go on an antibiotic for a week, and that pretty much will take care of the infection, and that doesn't translate into a big infection or an infection that's going to create a big problem. The risk of having an infection that would require the removal of the implant is probably about 1 or 2%, 1 to 2% based on our experience. So these are manageable bumps in the road. They do occasionally come up, but the likelihood of you being able to have long-term benefit from your implant with retention of your implant is in the high 90%. You know, amputation surgery has been around for a long time, but in general, amputee surgery is viewed as a very sort of depressing type of surgery. And I will say that the group of amputees out there often don't feel like their physicians are excited about treating them. And I think that that's played a part in sort of the psychological component of amputation as sort of this failure, and that, well, there's nothing else to do, so we need to do an amputation. And I think one of the things that I have noticed about osseointegration limb replacement surgery is that it has fostered a new era of excitement around this important field, and it has really risen to the top of this idea of an amputation reconstruction as opposed to just a cut off your leg type of surgery. I've been in the business of limb salvage surgery, deformity correction, for many, many years, and it is really fantastic for us to have this really powerful tool to offer patients as an alternative as you talk people through limb salvage versus amputation reconstruction. And it is interesting because there will be cases, sometimes you'll have two patients with very similar problems, and you know, you might present option one, which is a limb salvage surgery, and you might present option two, which is the amputation reconstruction with osseointegration. You know, for one person, one is a better option, and for the other person, the other is the better option. But it has really changed the way we think about this decision-making between amputation reconstruction and limb salvage. We've got a great team. We've got three surgeons who are actively doing osseointegration limb replacement surgery. We are a training program, so we have two fellows, we have three physician assistants, we have two nurses. We are an active team, very dynamic. We're at the Hospital for Special Surgery, which is the number one rated orthopedic hospital in the United States and in the world for many consecutive years. And we're up and running with this procedure. There's a lot of exciting stuff in the future. I think that custom-made implants are the key to really getting great fit and success. 3D printing implants using EBM technology, robotic prosthetics, and the ability to actually move the prosthetic just by thinking about it is an exciting area. And we are already doing that in the upper extremity, right? So when we do an osseointegration in the upper extremity and we have done in the humerus and in the forearm. It's a little bit different. You just don't want a prosthetic that is static. You want something that is myoelectric, something that will move and respond. And so signals created by the residual muscles, sometimes amplified, sometimes not amplified, those signals can be harvested on the surface of the skin, and the patient can learn to use signals from their residual muscles to motor a robotic arm. And that's an exciting, we've done several cases like that, and the results of that have been phenomenal. I really hope that this video has been educational, enlightening for you. We're happy to see you and evaluate you. Check us out on limblengthening.com or osseointegrationusa.com for more information. And I look forward to meeting you in person.